So, what is a video game? A video game is ultimately just a means to an end. A computer program, a kind of machine, built to provide a certain experience to the end user, in accordance to the game's design. So, what's an experience? The Cambridge English Dictionary describes an experience, noun, as either something that happens to you that affects how you feel, or the way that something happens to you and how that makes you feel. In other words, it's a psychological structure, in that it's created and contained within a mind, and it's subjective in that it happens to someone and can't be performed on someone. Like, you can't do happiness to someone, you do something and they become happy as a result of your actions. Now, the appeal of art, especially video games, which explicitly simulate interaction, is that the artist or designer can simulate all sorts of different experiences, not just happiness, but sadness or satisfaction or camaraderie or more complex ideas, like an understanding of life and the human condition, or a deep and abiding appreciation of the world around you, or, you know, whatever. There's a lot of range here. People are complicated. Following this idea, a design, also noun, is the specific image of an intended experience the designer has in their head that serves as a blueprint or target for the experience they want to foster in the player, which also has a lot of range. Game design can be arcadey or realistic or either or neither or both or, you know, whatever. But whatever the intended experience is, this design originates within the designer, the person designing, verb, whatever intended design. Simple so far, right? I mean, conjugation sucks, but that's English's fault, not art's. So, next question. How do designers design video games? See, the designer might not be able to beam experience directly into the player's head because experiences are psychological and only in the player's mind and can't be directly affected by the outside world, much less by some punk designer. But the designer can provide the information and context to simulate their design and let the player piece together their intended experience for themselves. All they have to do is create and arrange the material content of their art in such a way that guides the player's experience. And in the context of game design, this content takes the form of game mechanics, the rules and conditions of the game. However, mechanics don't exist individually, in a vacuum. They work together, in groups called systems, interacting with and contextualizing each other to allow the player to interact with the game world in more nuanced and interesting ways. And finally, these interactions, in turn, work with and contextualize each other to provide a more detailed and vivid overall experience. Like, for example, shooting a gun into a blank void might mean something like philosophically, but isn't engaging mechanically in and of itself. But if you give the player something to shoot, the two mechanics in combination can provide an interesting tactile response, for instance if the target dies when you kill it, an interesting challenge, for instance if the target is moving, and can clue the player into an interesting narrative, for instance if the target is shooting back. Actually, in the same way that the game as a whole is just a vehicle for a larger experience, you could say that mechanics, and the systems that they create, are just machines to foster interactions, which are basically just mini-experiences in and of themselves that combine into a larger whole. This is because the player doesn't necessarily respond to the rote numbers and equations sticking around inside your computer, especially if you don't surface any of that information. They interact with the feeling of interacting with that information, and how that information impacts the player's perceived reality. Kinda like how somebody driving a car doesn't necessarily know what their carburetor is, or what it's doing, beyond that it is part of the car, and the manual... Do people still read manuals? The manual says, whatever it is, it's important, don't touch it. Now, you might notice that there's a kind of order of operations to these relationships. The designer has most control over mechanics, which they can change directly, less control over systems, which are derived therefrom, and even less control over how the player interacts with and finally experiences the game, because both of those elements lie within the realm of the player's psychology. This pattern is actually consistent enough that we can arrange it into a discrete chart. So, under this paradigm, we might conclude that the anatomy of an experience, as it pertains to video games, might look something like this. Let's call this the MSIE model, because that sounds super fucking cool. And what's really interesting is that while this model might be a little bit on the simplistic side, for our purposes, that's a feature, not a bug. See, the next question you might be wondering is, why bother with a part again? Paradigm. Fuck. You might be wondering why bother with a paradigm, like why make it a thing at all? Simple, because unitizing understanding into a discrete model, using it like an object that we can specifically use to accomplish a specific goal, in this case, game design, allows us to analyze, criticize, and improve on that model if it fails to cover some facet of the subject matter. In other words, if MSIE doesn't perfectly model the anatomy of a player experience, we, or more accurately you, can pick out what aspects of it aren't working, why they're falling apart, and improve upon the model, or maybe improve upon the system, accordingly. But if our MSIE model is accurate, if player experience is structured in such a consistent way, then maybe we can think of game design, and honestly all forms of art, under the same paradigm. I said it right that time. Wait, why do I say paradigm? What did I say before? Paradigm? Why don't I say paradigm? Like para-D-I-G-M. Anyway, we could think of game design as a kind of system of systems. Lots of moving parts comprised of lots of other moving parts combining into a greater whole. And with an understanding of the underlying mechanics, exactly what parts are causing what things to happen, we can take those systems of systems apart, delineate and separate all the smaller systems that comprise them, and put them back together again into something new. In fact, no matter how complicated a game becomes, no matter how many moving parts make up a system of systems, you as a designer will always have the ability to change it just by popping the cyberhood and adding, subtracting, or modifying individual mechanics, which, as a result of these mechanics' interconnectedness with the rest of the game's composition, will have a domino effect all the way up. Just like how something as simple as adding targets to Immobile Shoot Gun Void added interesting interactions, challenges, and narrative intrigue, and how taking the carburetor out of your car caused your car to stop working. But for a more practical example, let's try something like a thought experiment. I've got this concept lying around for a game called Sky Giant Dowsinger, which is basically a derivative of Minecraft. So in this video, yeah, that was a 5-minute prologue, I'd like to walk you through the design, again the intended player experience, of the first act, or early game, in which the player is still coming to grips with how the world works and what kind of game they can expect to be playing. And while I'm describing this game to you, I want you to compare and contrast the image in your head with your experience playing Minecraft, and other games in the broader Minecroid genre. So, Sky Giant Dowsinger. Sky Giant Dowsinger is a concept project I wrote up specifically for DC, early April 2020. It actually has heritage with the very first project I wrote for fun during my recovery over my 2019-2020 hiatus, called, and I regret this, Mahozoku Letterbox, L-E-D-E-R Box. Now, compared to Dowsinger, Letterbox, you can't hear me but I'm nodding, was a slow-paced sandbox game about building a magical letterbox and receiving mail from nowhere commentating on the player's progress and their nature as a Mahozoku, a tradition of magicians who could draw magic from the natural world. And all that was back in August 2019, so my lone word aesthetic has only improved since then. So, Sky Giant Dowsinger, compared to Leaderbox, is less 2000s Kyoani Iyashike, or moreover, Kiki's Delivery Service era Ghibli, and it's more like super small scale or a Battler Dunbine. But actually, it still kind of feels like Ghibli, which is kind of interesting because literally my only point of reference is Kiki's Delivery Service. But don't worry if you don't know what any of that means. Dowsinger begins with you, the player, dropped on a desert island. The world is cubes. Incidentally, you look like this. It's technically a spoiler, but don't worry about it. Anyway, so the player, who recognizes cubes, thinks to themselves, "Oh yo! Minecraft!" So their pre-existing Minecraft conditioning kicks in. So the player gets up, bolts off into the fucking woods, and begins to punch down trees. And to their surprise, a short-range laser beam bursts out of their fucking eyes and burns its way through the fucking trunk. And the whole tree comes crashing down to the ground. "Yo!" the player thinks. "Weird Minecraft!" So the player goes on with their conditioning, and the game more or less abides them. They make wood, make a table, make a pick, mine stone, which laser eyes don't work on. Laser eyes seem to be the equivalent of punching, so I guess that's just how punching works around here. They mine stone, make a stone pick, break into the underground, fart around underground for a little while, and then eventually discover native copper. So they slap together a furnace, and discover that they have no coal, which is a pain in the ass, and smelt the copper into bars, and go to make a copper pick, and discover that they can make this. This is called a dowsing rod. No spaces, all one word. All it is metal and wood. Holding it in your hands charges it with energy, which allows you to fire fast and accurate bolts of bright yellow light. You can even hold more than one, charge it, and put it in your inventory, and as long as it doesn't leave your person, it won't lose its charge. This becomes important when you discover that once you empty one dowsing rod, it's automatically replaced by your next charged dowsing rod in your inventory. "Oh yo!" the player thinks. "Gun Minecraft!" So, the dowsing rod, despite its name, doesn't actually help you discover metals or treasure, but it does make exploring the island a lot easier. Animals hate getting shot for one thing, but also dowsing rods work as a kind of tractor beam, kind of like an extension of your natural desire that you use to cut down your first tree, letting you break certain materials like stone and copper, anything a similar level pickaxe would be able to break, basically, and pull them into your inventory at range. The only real downside, especially without any durability to worry about, is that it takes a little while to recharge, and sometimes you might want to save your shots for something else, like self-defense. But that's a problem that can be solved with technique and experimentation. In fact, it's just useful enough, in a variety of roles, that you might not use it for literally everything, but you'll at least try using it on everything. So the dowsing rod becomes a new and exciting move in the player's move set. And now, with the dowsing rod in hand, the player is able to explore the area safely, although if they're really bold, they could probably just pull it off barehanded. Either way, the player eventually notices that they don't seem to be able to leave the island. There doesn't seem to be anything physically obstructing you or anything, but you can't just swim away either, because you can't really swim at all. At best, you can sort of, like, dog paddle. See, you have to manually jump in water to stay afloat, which slowly exhausts you, like sprinting, and you can't build a boat yet either. But besides that, it's not so bad. Wild animals actually seem to leave you alone as long as you don't, like, shoot at them or anything, and they're easy enough to avoid. Like, there are boars on the island that'll stare you down and attack if you get too close, but only if you get too close. And there are things like hawks that'll harass you if you get too close to their nest. And in trees there are beehives that spawn only slightly giant bees, which still only really bother you if you knock down the tree. And all of these threats are pretty clearly telegraphed, so you don't really have to worry about them unless you're hungry and need food. So, because there are no real enemies so far, the only real threats so far are like fall damage, starvation, drowning, and nighttime, and only because you can't really see what you're fucking doing. So if you just kinda walk off into the woods at night, you're probably not gonna get eaten by like a predator, but you might like walk into a deer or something and get mule kicked into fucking space, but otherwise it's been weirdly calm. A couple nights into your stay on the island, that changes when this thing appears. There's no monster dictionary or achievements or anything giving you a name, so you have no clue what the fuck this is. But if he sees you, he stares at you, and then slowly begins to approach you. If you shoot him with a dowsing rod, he apparently goes down instantly, but really he just teleports away underneath the flash of light at the end of the beam, before homing in on you again. Really, the only way you can tell it's the same entity is that now, when it shows up again, it starts shooting fucking lasers at you! Right now, the only safe way to engage him is by ducking behind cover while he's charging up his beam and making sure he doesn't have a clear shot when he fires. Which is a pain in the ass, because he doesn't actually walk straight toward you, he goes back and forth, left and right. And if he goes wide enough around your cover, he might flank you and just shoot around the thing that you're hiding behind anyway. And the whole time, he's still coming toward you, so he's still trying to shove himself directly in your fucking face! And finally, the worst part is that he doesn't have a fucking audio cue. He's dead silent. And if this fucking thing notices you before you notice him, he'll sneak up on you and turn you into a fucking Christmas light if you don't put something between you and him in the second it takes for him to charge up a shot. Naturally, this motherfucker seems to only appear in darkness, and you don't really have a lot of light sources yet. Actually, the most consistent lighting you have so far is your dowsing rod fire, like the muzzle flash from the shot, so there's not a lot of options to keep him away. But, if you manage to kill this thing, and honestly, he's not really that tough of a fight, one, this is the very first enemy, and two, he keeps trying to melee you with a laser beam, he can't be that smart, he's just really slippery. But, if you do manage to take down one of these things, it drops an item called black powder. A while back, when you first made that copper dowsing rod, you also learned a recipe for something called a copper dowsinger, which requires clay, which you can make from a lot of dirt, a lot of copper, and black powder, which has now just fallen into your lap. So you gather the appropriate materials, which unfortunately means having to deal with more of these fucking creepazoids, throw the thing together, clear some space, and build the Dowsinger, a safe distance away from your base. It turns out, it's kinda like a lantern. It glows in the dark. Little pebbles begin to lift off the ground around it. It hums. What's interesting is that you can interact with it. If you open up the Dowsinger and put in a dowsing rod, it charges a dowsing rod really quickly. You can even put in several dowsing rods at once, so you can reload your whole inventory all at once, instead of having to do them one by one. And it turns out, you can put in normal tools as well, turning them into dowsing tools with special properties. Dowsing picks, at the cost of a huge amount of durability, blast out a huge 7x7 chunk of rock. And dowsing shovels do the same thing for dirt and soft materials, and dowsing axes do the same thing for wood. Which seems kind of redundant, because trees already fall down anyway. It seems like the only downside is just how much durability they go through per use. For reference, wood and stone tools only get one use before breaking, and copper tools only get two. But it's not, like, such a big deal. I mean, you could always just build more. Now that you're armed with dowsing gear, it doesn't take too long before you turn the entire island upside down looking for your next upgrade. You find iron, silver, and other minerals like quartz, but never anything special like diamond. Despite the fact that you'll probably hit bedrock, or at least something like bedrock, before you really need to upgrade anything. Actually, stone dowsing tools can get you basically anywhere you need to go inside the underground. The real question is what you're gonna do with all the extra stone. Speaking of iron and silver, dowsing rods, it turns out, change form depending on what metal you use to make them. Like, the basic copper dowsing rod is just this traditional dowsing space rod shape, but the iron dowsing rod has this magazine-like, foregrip-like structure on the front, and fires like an automatic. Then, the silver dowsing rod looks more like an Okawara rifle, and it fires single powerful shots that can be charged up to fire explosions. This also gives the player access to a rocket jump, which is, of course, in the grand tradition of rocket jumps, secretly thematically relevant. And these new weapons turn out to be a godsend, because as time goes on, that black powder monster gets company. In addition to the basic humanoid figure that silently tries to flank you that we're familiar with, there's this new enemy type that moves around by phasing through the world geometry and can surprise you by just appearing while you're not paying attention, to either physically ram you if you're standing too close to the wall, or shoot beams at you as it slowly strafes past, before just clipping back into the wall again and hiding itself as it comes around for another pass. Another enemy appears as a black, glass-like block that camouflages itself in the dark underground, which, when disturbed, bursts out of its hiding spot and starts floating around the room like a 3D DVD logo, waking up all of its friends by shooting beams at you. And then there's another enemy that appears like a kind of pyramid shape poking out of the floor, like the stalagmites and stalactites that naturally generate, until you get too close, and it shoots up into the ceiling to block your way. And so do all of its friends. And another similar enemy grows out of the oceans at night, and sometimes during the day, towering above the water's surface like fence posts or like the bars of a prison cell. And of course, if you stick around too long, it starts shooting at you. And all of these fuckers have a tendency to lie in wait, especially in darkness, to ambush you. They have tells, sure, the first fucker makes a fucking, like, a static noise, and the other two you can see before they attack, but that's a real small comfort. They come in groups, and they all have some kind of weird fucking gimmick, and sometimes they just fucking warp away, but then they just fucking come back, and they get the jump on you again? So you can never tell if you're safe, or if you've just bought breathing room, and it's distressing to say the least. But with the discovery of native silver, you gain the ability to make a silver Dowsinger. Outside of the silver, it's not too much more expensive than the copper Dowsinger, so it's easy enough to put together. You just have to get the parts together. When you place it on the ground, the Dowsinger emits a flash of bright lights. Bits of rocks and debris rise off the ground briefly, and the Dowsinger begins to hum and rumble as the light begins to shimmer unsteadily. Slowly, the terrain around you begins to rise, and then eventually separates from the fucking block grid and rises into the air! Until finally breaking free of the surface and hovering up into the sky and just floating there! You can still see the Dowsinger on top, it's still glowing, but like, in fact, not only is it not on the fucking block grid anymore, it's fucking turning with fucking inertia. Is it supposed to do that? Like, you, eventually, you get the bright idea to, you know, maybe you should go up there and see what's going on. And it's not that high up. You can just climb up there if you try. Like, if you just get on top of a tree and you can just jump on top of it. But you notice that over time, dirt and stone blocks are beginning to fall off the chunk of earth, and eventually, if nothing's supporting the Dowsinger just falls to the ground too, and you have to go get it and set it back up again. But it wasn't a one-time thing. You can just do that now. With some experimentation, you discover that only man-made materials like wood, clay, and metal stick to the Dowsinger, and only while in direct contact. And even then, you can't go too far out. You can go like maybe 7 blocks before the platform begins to shake itself apart. And if the player tries to build something at the crafting table, they'll realize that the Silver Dowsinger has revealed all sorts of new recipes to create all sorts of new equipment. Dowsing tanks? Dowsing thrusters? Stabilizers? Control panels? By this point, the player has a lot of questions. The first one, inevitably, is what the fuck is a Dowsinger? And the second question is probably, how does a Dowsinger work? And what's it got to do with dowsing rods? And why can I charge things in the Dowsinger in the same way that I can charge things in my hands? Actually, what is a dowsing rod? Wait, can I snipe monsters from up here? If not, what's stopping me, and can I work around it? What's with these fucking black powder monsters anyway? Can they reach me up here? They shoot beams. Some of them fly, and some of them are just very tall. And wait, what is black powder anyway, and why did I need it for the Dowsinger? What else can I do with the Dowsinger? If I make thrusters and power them with the Dowsinger, can I control this fucking flying rock? If I can make an airship with the Dowsinger, can I get off this island? Where else is there to go? Wait, this is only the Silver Dowsinger, right? Like, if we're working off linear progression rules, then there must be a Gold Dowsinger next, right? What does the next level of Dowsinger look like? What does the next level of Dowsinger do? Why are my eyes tractor beams? But just because the player has a lot of questions, doesn't mean that the game is in a rush to answer them. As it stands, the airship isn't really that useful. In order for it to do anything besides float there in space, it needs to have thrusters to move around. But thrusters take up more energy than the Dowsinger can output, so it needs to draw power from tanks, which work kinda like a capacitor. Then it needs control panels to control everything from, and stabilizers to hold the whole thing together. The Dowsinger only has so much range before things begin to fall off, and just building more Dowsingers is prohibitively expensive. But that's like, what, three things? That's nothing! You've done three things before and you'll do three things again. And even before the airship is fully equipped, it can fly anywhere on the island. It just can't get any distance away from the island with the most basic power supply. That is, one silver Dowsinger, no tanks, one thruster. See, without tanks, it can fly for a little while, but it can't make any significant distance out before it needs to recharge. And if you just sit there on the coast without moving, those fucking giant tentacle bar things that you can see from the shore, which now seem to be forming an explicit barrier around the island, start shooting at you, pushing you back onto dry land. It's still very useful on the island, however. Like, if a player stands directly beneath a Dowsinger and has a clear line of sight up, they can use its levitation effect as a giant tractor beam to slowly rise up onto the airship, or inversely, descend from the airship without cratering like a big dumb idiot. Additionally, if the player dies, they respawn on, or underneath, their most powerful Dowsinger. And finally, you can place basically anything on the airship as long as it's supported by, that is to say, directly on top of, a man-made block. For instance, you can put down beds, which will heal you after a quick nap, and also skip forward in the day if you're sick of dealing with the mean beam machine for the night. You can also put down crafting tables, you can put down storage, and finally have somewhere to put all that fucking stone you've been digging up all game. You can even make clay pots and grow small plants, like wheat and berries. In other words, the airship is designed to become your new home, if only out of convenience. Which means you don't actually have to build anything on the island anymore. Everything that matters to you is now hovering a couple dozen blocks up in the sky. And not only that, but the game has just promised to you that you'll be able to fly to other islands, which means that you're free to continue exploiting the blasted, fallowed rock you washed up on as you please. From the air, the player finally gets a good look at their effects on the island. Dowsing tools blast out huge 7x7 craters in the landscape, way faster, way more deliberately, way more efficiently than creepers ever could. In order to make clay, you have to combine and compact dirt, which means you have to dig up a lot of dirt just to make a little clay. Which means not only are there huge quarries carved in the ground, but there are places, pits, trenches, whatever you want to call them, where the topsoil is just gone. There used to be life here. Birds, deer, boars, bees, trees. Now the forest is quiet because the forest is gone. What's left is floating in the sky. But if the player's goal is to get off this island and see what else there is to explore, and there must be more to explore, right? Why would the game give them an airship if they weren't supposed to use it? If their goal was to get off this island, then what else were they supposed to do? In order to build the airship, they need Dowsingers, which means they need copper and silver and quartz, I think, which means they have to dig. They had to dig, right? For now, there isn't really a good answer. In order to build an airship that's capable of leaving the island, the materials you need to make that airship have to be pulled from the earth. The best the player can do right now is be aesthetically pleasing about it, like cover their tracks, fill in pits, round out strip mined walls, but there's still a wound. The airship shows you where you've been. The geography is different. The geometry is different. The geology is different. There's still probably a big dumb hole in the ground where the airship first took off. If not, there's a concrete scar. Maybe there was a better way, but the damage has been done. As the player finally leaves the island, there's a huge stretch of ocean. They might have to stop to let the tanks recharge a couple times, but it's mostly just open space. It's peaceful out here again, like it was those first couple days. There's nothing to hurt you out here, nothing hiding in the darkness, nothing jumping out from beneath your feet, nothing sneaking up on you, nothing. The open sea rolls out forever, in all directions, with no end in sight. You can go fishing by shooting your dowsing rod over the side of the ship. You can visit tiny little micro-islands, little archipelago dots and shoals that you can use for navigation. Sometimes strange plants and animals appear here, providing food and medicine. At night, monsters can spawn here, and of course they'll fucking shoot beams at you, but all you have to do is duck inside your ship, and the problem solves itself. If you wanted to, You could spend days out here, aimlessly wandering the open sky. But if you just pick a direction and go, you'll get where you're going in 10 minutes. Eventually, the player spots another big island. Or rather, they spot smoke rising from a chimney. People live on this island. Once again, the player's head is instantly filled to burst with questions. Are they friendly? Are they hostile? Can I talk to them? Can I chat with them? How do they deal with the monsters? Wait, how did they get here? What are they doing out here? What are they doing here? What can I do with them? First contact with other islanders marks the end of Dowsinger's early game. Narratively speaking, it's also the end of Act 1 in a traditional Western three-act structure. In other words, the setting has been set up, the conflict has been set up, and the stage has been set, the precedent has been set, for the player to have even more complicated and nuanced interactions with the game world throughout the rest of the game, and beyond. This is good for us as designers, because now we have all the boring groundwork out of the way, and now we have a whole game's worth of narrative, well, ludonarrative, and mechanics we can explore. But what's interesting is the player is just as excited, because now we are over the awkward tutorial-esque phase of the game, and now we're nice and settled into this new game's mechanics and world-building, and have a general feel for how the game works and where it's going, so we can spend the next two-thirds of the game just seeing where the game wants to go. And you might be thinking something like, why is signaling what the rest of the game is gonna do important? Why not just teach the player as they go? What's the significance of the three-act structure in game design, and are there other structures to draw inspiration from? Is there a two-act structure? Is there a four-act structure? What the hell is a Kisho Tenketsu? And boy, am I glad you fucking asked! But this video is already running long, and it's already jam-packed with information, so maybe you should keep that in mind for next time. But for now, here's something to chew on. Just like how there are systemic differences between Minecraft and Dowsinger that result in two very different experiences, there are systemic differences between interactive storytelling, like video games, and non-interactive storytelling, like literature and film, that can cause designers to approach their craft in different ways. Actually, wait, hold on, I want to talk about this. This meta-relationship actually hints at an even bigger idea, that systems and systemic interactions aren't just present in art and design, but in every aspect of life. The myriad ways that you, and everything around you, are acted on and act upon others is reflected in everything that we do. The food that we eat, the people that we meet, even the things that we decide to talk about, help define and are defined by the world around us. And just like with game design, even tiny changes can have profound effects in the systems that we inhabit, and the people that we share them with, if you can work out what it is that needs to change. We can even change systems within ourselves as well. According to Dr. Kevin Chapman's cognitive model, the basis on which I based our MSIE model, there are three components to the ways humans experience the world: an event that prompts our interaction, our personal interpretation of that event, and our resulting feelings from our resulting interpretation of that event. So, if we want to change the way that we experience the world, for instance, if we want to be less angry or less fearful or less sad, we could change the events that happen in the material world around us, or we could be mindful of and question how we respond to these events and why. Of course, there is nuance to this statement. Sometimes anger, fear, or sadness really is the appropriate response, and it could be unhealthy to deny your own emotions. For instance, if you suffer a significant loss, it's good to grieve. It's part of the natural healing process, and you'll be better off in the long run. But at the same time, if you fly into a rage whenever you don't get your way and you end up hurting the people you care about, maybe it's worth questioning why you respond like that, and seeing if you can do something about it. But the reason I bring this up is because changing your own mind, under your own power, for your own reasons, is one thing. But forcing the same change onto others, forcing someone else to perform what you have personally judged for them to be a more healthy mindset, even with the best intentions, is not helpful. If they do come around to see your point of view, they have to do so on their own terms. Trying to force the issue is an unwelcome breach of boundaries, and it could constitute a kind of psychological abuse. It's kind of like grabbing someone and physically forcing them to wash their hands. Like, no matter what the fuck you think you're doing, the act of literally manhandling them is an act of violence, and you are doing more harm than good. Same goes for psychological manipulation. Goes double for psychological manipulation. But this has an interesting implication for the mechanisms belying art. After all, artists and designers are literally manipulating a fiction in order to provoke a particular psychological experience. So, what is the difference, exactly, between an artist and an abuser? The short answer is, art has a couple built-in countermeasures keeping artists from going too far. When you choose to interact with a piece of media, you are also able to choose when to stop. you consent to interact with its content, its themes, its message, its potential impact on your worldview, and you can revoke that consent at any time. In other words, art isn't forcing anyone to do anything. People engage with art because they want to, not because they have to. But at the same time, I still think it's the artist's responsibility, the designer's responsibility, to properly telegraph psychological elements, to choose to impart enriching, useful information, and ultimately, to do no harm. But, like I said, this video is already running really long, and this is a complex topic, so let's get into the dynamics and ethics of art and consent another time. But I think it's important that we at least touch on the topic's significance, especially in a field as psychologically involved as game design. But until then, that's just another thing to think about. Anyway, if you've been keeping tabs on exactly where and how Dowsinger differs from Minecraft, you've probably noticed a lot of interesting mechanical differences. To review what we've learned about the relationships between mechanics, systems, interactions, and experiences, let's take a closer look at the differences between Dowsinger's and Minecraft's approaches to combat. In Minecraft, combat tends to be fairly straightforward. In practice, you make a strong sword or you enchant a strong bow and you put on your strongest armor and then run in and kill the opponent before the opponent kills you. There is some skill involved. For instance, you can hit the target at the edge of your range in order to make sure he can't do collision damage. Certain enemies have quirks to their movement patterns that make them harder to hit, and in the later game, you start fighting in precarious arenas, but you can usually just smash through the enemies themselves once you get decent gear. In addition, it's also fairly easy to avoid combat, either by putting down torches to keep enemies from spawning, or by simply not going into places like the Nether or the End where the more dangerous enemies live. As a result, the well-equipped player plays Minecraft like a warrior. They may not be looking for a fight, but once they're in the fray, combat is violent, mindless fun. It isn't especially involved, but it is still presented as a challenge to overcome in and of itself. And as you go through the game, in particular as you get your hands on better equipment, combat actually becomes easier and easier, until ultimately, by endgame, the player has become an invincible conquering demigod, and feels as though they have totally mastered the game and their domain. There is some nuance, however. For instance, in the early game, creepers and skeletons in particular are huge threats that can kill the player extremely quickly and without a lot of warning, with a power discrepancy pushing the player to become more powerful and spurring the development of better arms and armor. However, the player is a lot less confident when they aren't actually prepared, so the first night or so before you hit iron tends to be an exercise in hiding in holes. And this feeling actually has an interesting reprise at the end of the game, where the player is threatened less by direct enemy attack and more by hazards like drowning or fall damage or lava or the literal void, all hazards that the player cannot prepare for. However, if this is a reprise, I think it's executed clumsily. I actually don't think it's even intentional per se. Hubristic death by spleef strikes me as less like a well-thought-out experience-deepening deliberacy and more like an ad hoc contrivance of game design. Or rather, it makes me think that someone forgot that Minecraft's progression system makes the player basically invincible at the end of the game, but they decided that they wanted to challenge the player with a combat encounter anyway, so it feels like a fluke, is what I'm trying to say. But, of course, that's just my reading. Now, Dowsinger's combat, compared to Minecraft's, is much less decisive and a little more involved. You can't just fucking dive in and start swinging your sword until either you or your target dies, because you have a fucking gun, and as a result, you have gun responsibilities. Let's take, for example, a basic skirmish with Figure, that fucking teleporty shadow monster thing. This fucking jelly jiggler-looking motherfucker. See, both you and the Figure have ranged attacks, which means you have to keep track of the terrain between yourself and the target in order to keep track of the cover between yourself and the target. And in addition, because the dowsing rods run on an ammo system, you also have to keep track of the remaining charge left in your gun. Especially in case you miss, which is more of a factor in ranged combat than it is in melee, if only because the target is smaller on your screen. Although, it is worth noting that the figure isn't just gonna stand there and shoot at you, it moves toward you, erratically moving side to side, firing back to pressure you into cover, and this is the important part, it teleports around whenever you deal damage. This means the player has to consider not just where the figure is right now, but where the figure went once it takes a hit, which means the player has to have an awareness of both their flanks and their blind spots before the enemy reappears for round two. But because of this lull in combat while the enemy's trying to get back to where it was before, the player is also presented with the opportunity to stand and fight or retreat while the encounter has been broken off. Finally, other enemies have similar encounter designs, basically flashes of violence followed by tense observation. So while Figure might be the most memorable interaction, he's really just the tip of the iceberg. So in summary, compared to Minecraft, Dowsinger's combat system is designed to play somewhat slower, but it is more nuanced. Not only is there more pressure, but the player has more options to exert control. Now, to illustrate how changing one system has a domino effect on other systems, let's consider how Dowsinger's combat system is also affected by its progression system. Compared to Minecraft, the player becomes better at killing enemies, but not better at surviving them. The iron and silver dowsing rods get rid of figures faster, but if a figure gets a shot off, he's still going to take the same amount of damage and knock back an emotional damage either way. The only way you can avoid taking a hit is by killing the enemy first, hiding behind cover, or by backflipping out of the room and escaping the encounter altogether. This helps retain the early game tension and keeps the player from ever feeling like they can completely disregard enemies. Unlike how once you get blast protection, or really any decent armor at all, creepers stop being such a big threat, a figure sneaking up on you and drilling you a new auxiliary fart vent never stops being a problem. And, as a result of how these systems working together influences the player's ultimate behavior, the player interacts with the world of Dowsinger very differently from how they would interact with the world of Minecraft. For one, the Dowsinger player never gets the luxury of becoming an unstoppable killing machine capable of outright ignoring low-level threats, unlike the Minecraft player who can laugh off basically anything if he has the right equipment. This disparity informs a kind of character. In order to survive in this new world of getting shot at by beams with no armor, the Dowsinger player becomes first alert and tactically aware, and second, kind of suspicious and untrusting. Like, they're constantly scanning their environment for any signs of danger, unless they're safely aboard their airship, where they can relax, collect themselves, survey the situation from above, improve their equipment and support system, i.e. the airship itself, and finally prepare themselves for their next trip to the surface. Additionally, the fact that Dowsinger revolves around an airship, not a static fortification like a house or a castle or a 3x3 hole in the ground, means that the Dowsinger player is actually free not to fight, but explore a little more aggressively. A side effect of Minecraft's combat being really reliant on equipment progression and decisive is that combat encounters are really pass-fail. For instance, if you just dive in and have good enough equipment, you'll kick whatever's ass no problem. But if you don't have good enough gear, you usually just die, or run away, with the thing that defeated you either in hot pursuit or just standing there menacingly wherever you found them. See, there isn't really any nuance. The combat isn't involved enough to have situations where you only survived due to skill or quick thinking. The only variable is equipment, and possibly terrain. All this makes it very important that the Minecraft player prepare ahead of time, because you don't want to travel 50 shitzillion miles of wilderness, or the raging inferno of Satan's butthole, or the vacuous absentia of Nyarlhotep's butthole, just to realize you didn't bring enough arrows or food or whatever and splatter yourself on whatever you're fighting anyway, which means expeditions to the Nether and the End are predicated by literal time in the mines, grinding material like diamond or iron until you have all the equipment you need to take another serious run. But in Dowsinger, you're always kind of fragile and the underdog, even against enemies you've already mastered, because all the preparation you can really do is make sure that all your dowsing rods are charged and you haven't left the thrusters on at home or something. You can't build armor, and your weapons appear to run on guts alone, so once you have a gun, you're as ready as you'll ever be. Plus, once you get your airship, you can really just park the damn thing directly over whatever feature you're trying to explore. So if you're really having a problem with, like, one specific kind of enemy encounter that specifically appears in this one particular segment of this particular mine or forest or butthole, you can theoretically brute force the problem by just dropping directly from your respawn onto the target's head. Like, is this a long-term solution? No. Like, if that enemy shows up again, and spoilers, it will, and your only strategy to kill it is a fucking manual airstrike, and you don't have your airship parked outside because you didn't expect it would show up here, and all you have is a gun and a single beleaguered brain cell that hasn't learned anything from the last encounter, whatever enemy tore you a second asshole is just gonna tear you a third. But, on the bright side, you don't have to deal with so much busy work to get back to interacting with whatever interesting enemy encounter again, because the distance between your airship and any point on the island should be just long enough to get the player back in character for the encounter again, which means the interaction can resume unabated. Speaking of character, however, it is worth noting that, at least as far as we've discussed, Dowsinger's early game player psychology isn't so different from Minecraft's early game player psychology. Like, broadly speaking, you could easily call Dowsinger Minecraft Gun Edition, and you're basically correct. Like, the systemic differences are significant, but they aren't so significant for a full-on change in format. Dowsinger still progresses at least a little like Minecraft, but the tiny nuances, the subtleties, the turn of the heel into self-awareness of its internal systems and the trappings of its source material, the indication that Dowsinger might be going in a different direction, and the mystery of what that direction actually is, are enough to produce a different experience. Now, the only question left is, where are we going with this? Well, I guess you'll just have to wait and see. Taking a step back for a second, this particular pattern of game design, taking an existing formula and modifying it into something new, is pretty popular in both the video game industry proper and the indie industry for a variety of reasons. But the most relevant point for this video is that it's extremely intuitive and makes a great tool for designers who are just starting out. In fact, it's so intuitive that a lot of fledgling designers don't even know what they're doing counts as game design. They might just think that they've downloaded a cool mod for Skyrim off the internet, and now they're gonna make the combat less fucky. But what Jimmy Skyrim Pants doesn't know is that even with that tiny change, his dumbass has just committed a game design. And honestly, I would argue there's no better way to start. Making an entirely internally motivated attempt to improve your own personal experience could very well be the first step toward creating more sophisticated experiences for others. At least, that's how I got started, all those moons ago, when spinfusers still roamed the earth. Like, remember, all game design really is the practice of building games to suit a particular design, and technically all a design is whatever the designer wants it to be. And if you'll indulge my dumbass for a second, I think the hallmark of good design is when the designer creates a machine that does exactly what they wanted with no loose ends, no useless parts, and nothing that hampers the experience. And great design is when that machine does all that and more. See, if your goals are straightforward, then design can be easy. A nail is a special stick with a flat end, so it's easy to hit with a hammer. A hammer is a different stick with a wide, heavy head, so it's easier to hit in nails. A screwdriver is a straight stick with a thin end to fit into screws. And a screw is a funny stick with an indent on top so you can turn it with a screwdriver. So much to say, design, at its most basic level, isn't so complicated. It's just the practice of making things that facilitate some kind of specific task. The complexity, the arts, and the fun in being a designer is creating complex systems to accomplish complex tasks. Finding ways to arrange simple machines into something more meaningful and beautiful and inspiring than the rote sum of its parts. So, next time you're thinking of swinging by Minecraft mods or whatever, instead of just diving into most popular, think about what exactly you think Minecraft is missing. And see if you can't put together something along those lines yourself. You don't have to make any new mods or anything, you can just kitbash whatever's handy. But I do hear that Java is easy enough to pick up, although I will admit that I've only ever played with texture packs, and surely there are tutorials out there. And like, yeah, I know, 12-year-olds are really smart, but like, you were 12 once too. That said, when it comes to this project, I feel like I have basically done nothing. Like, I was ready to mess around with all sorts of experimental design shit for Dowsinger, but I guess I didn't really have to? Nor would a video about an introduction to game design have really been the right time. Like, a lot of the legwork has already been done for us, and that's kind of the point, right? It's still basically Minecraft. Wasted to move, click to shoot, beam trees to get wood. Which is good, for the sake of our argument. But now that the boring tutorializing Act 1 shit is out of the way, we can finally start getting into the fun stuff. Modding isn't the only way to make video games, you know? There's a whole wide world out there. Weird shit to try, weird shit to see. So, next time, let's try another approach. Instead of sticking to formula, let's see if we can't innovate. I hear VR is still a frontier right now, and projectile combat seems like a pretty good fit. So, next time, instead of working around an existing design, we'll explore designing games from the ground up with Soul Signal Zeitgeist. And next time, on Sky Giant Dowsinger, Sky Imperialism. Wait, shit.